Jim Thackard saw the obvious, even as it was oblivious to everyone else. From custom light boards that set new industry standards to the first foray into moving lights to, oh, I don't know, how about a little light for that console? Bob Peterson says it best. Jim Thackard is the MacGyver of the entertainment business. With an idea, a pile of parts, and a tube of RTV, anything could happen. And many things did. Thackard was born in St. Louis in 1948. Growing up in the University City section of town, he'd take the trolley to movies, where he was particularly enamored of science fiction flicks in general and Japanese Godzilla films in particular. Godzilla! When Russia's Sputnik flew over his house in 1957, his father made sure they were on the roof to see it. The family would move to Elkhart, Indiana. In school there, the science teacher encouraged him to do experiments beyond the regular stuff. He took a correspondence course in space and missile electronics. While it didn't get him to the moon, it did get him into all things electrical. Despite not being a particularly good student, he got into what is now Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, but alas, flunked calculus twice and dropped out. Drawn to music, he sang and played guitar in a band. Not satisfied with the gear available, he would build his own amps from scratch. He bounced back and forth between schools and his band until he found himself working for a company called Portable Audio in Ann Arbor. Suddenly, he was working with some of the biggest Detroit-based bands of the time. Here, he happily worked 80 hours a week for $50, building and fixing gear. Thackard wasn't the only new hire. Stefan Graf, a struggling Detroit musician, also signed on, and soon the two were sharing an apartment. Grand Funk Railroad was doing a festival that Thackard and Graf were working. They were a big group that demanded a big sound, and they left for dead many a sound system in their wake. Because all the Detroit bands played everything at 11, we knew that making a durable, unblowable system was key, Thackard recalls, adding that they were ahead of the game at the time. Manager Terry Knight and the band were so impressed, they took Thackard and Graf on the road with them. When the band took a break to sue their manager, Thackard went to the Easttown Theater in Detroit, where he worked with some of the greatest artists of the day. These were the days before a light show, when bands just worked with whatever house lights the venue had. So when legendary lighting designer Bill McManus drove up with the Doors in a station wagon filled with lighting gear, Thackard took notice. The resistive dimmer board that they helped haul in and set up on the stage was a revelation to him. The first thing Thackard did was replace the fader on the console with bump buttons, and thus his foray into lighting had begun. When Grand Funk Railroad returned to the road, Thackard and Graf built a lighting system for the band, consisting of some scrimmers and 44 1,000-watt par lamps. The two realized they needed more control, so Thackard built a lighting console from scratch, one of the first boards built rock and roll rugged. From this moment on, when something would break down, Thackard would rebuild the part so it wouldn't break again. It was good for the band, but for his roommates, not so much. Bits of gear were everywhere, including the kitchen. This made for grouchy roommates who had to eat their cereal wherever they could find the space. At a Shea Stadium event, famed LD Chipmunk was called in to work with GFR, and they were inspired by his structural lighting system. They used something similar in their ever-evolving rig. Through the 1970s, the two constantly improved the lighting system. Instead of clamping lights to a pipe, they bolted them. They also came up with a multi-conductor cabling system. Genie towers were put to use too. Graff formed Fantasy Lighting during this decade and told Thackert if he built a professional light board, Graff would market it. The LP1000 was born. David Millie of TLS recalls getting his hands on one during a Jimmy Buffett tour. He says the 24-channel board with a Matrix pin patch was revolutionary. He would acquire hundreds of Thackert's dimmers as well. One night, Thackert and Graff were talking about the problem that was GFR guitarist singer Mark Farner. The formidable showman was all over the stage in concert, and keeping him lit was tough. Thackert mentioned he had been reading about cable motors and knew he could get some at a military surplus store. What if they could be used to run a spot remotely with a joystick? Graff says he couldn't get his head around it at the time. It was too science fiction for him. But he threw a few hundred bucks at Thackert, and in a dingy basement, the Cyclops was built. Thackert was like a mad scientist, working until 4 in the morning, and when he was finished, it looked like a one-eyed monster. Typical of Thackert, he says it was easy, it's just no one had thought about doing it before. Thackert continued working out of a barn in Superior Township with Graff, and other developments came, including the Rainbow CX-7 color changers. But one of his biggest contributions turned out to be one of the smallest, the little light. Thackert said he didn't think much of his little light on his board until he got a call from a guy in Oregon asking if he could have one for his console. It spawned a second company in 1980. Many other products continued through the years. Reflecting back, he says, "Who could ask for more than this for a career? What a way to spend your 20s. Touring the world with bands, and what a way to spend your 30s designing products for the live event industry." And beyond, away from his workbench, he works out his self-described geek mind and other calming pursuits, like building fireworks and rockets. Graff tells this story of Thackert, whom he calls a spiritual person. One time they were in the barn shop they shared, and some bumblebees got in. Thackert calmly captured them in his hands, carried them outside, and let them go. Graff kept saying he'd get stung. Thackert's response, "No, as long as you don't put that kind of energy out, they won't bother you." "I think it's long past time for this award for Brother Thackert," declares guitarist Mark Farner, "but know this, Jim's innovations have come from his own personal practicality. Some folks would say he's a half a bubble off. I say, if that's true, then it's off in the upward direction. He's one of a kind. So just stand back and love him."